So the point of these digital leaders briefings, this is the fourth of them that we've run, and the point of them is to work from the principle that that everybody in this room kind of knows more or less where they stand on where we are at the moment in the digital transformation of the world that's going on. So what we want to do is we want to look at what's coming next. We want to look at the things that are going to be shaping businesses in the future. And today we're looking at the age of participation. Obviously, this is a subject that's close to our hearts as an organization. And what we want to do is we want to look at what happens when your audience, your customers, start to talk back. What you can do, how you can manage that, and the value that you can derive from that. Because, you know, as we all know, they're going to do it anyway. It kind of, you know, whether you like it or not, whether you're prepared for it or not, you know, your customers are going to be talking about you, engaging with each other, with you, with the wider world. So how can you derive value from that? We've got, as I say, four great speakers. We'll hear from Ava Pascoe and Peter Ward before coffee. We'll break for coffee at about 3 o'clock, just before 3 o'clock. Then we'll hear from Christophe Langlois and finally Rod Banner. And then after that, there'll be drinks, networking downstairs. And after that, there'll be opportunity to carry on the conversation in the Square Pub just over the road behind the sandwich shop that's massively capitalizing on its fame in the TV series Sherlock. Okay, so without further ado, I'm going to hand over to our first speaker, Ava Pascoe. I first met Ava in about 2000 when she had relatively recently launched Siberia, the first internet cafe in the UK. She was an inspiration to me when I was just starting editing New Media Age, and to many other people, showing us, you know, what the internet could do. So I'm absolutely delighted that she's able to be here to give the first presentation today. Ava, over to you.
Right, I don't want wet trousers, so I have a rabbit and I will produce it. Okay, let me just find my slides. Right, Michael suffers from extremely short memory because we actually met in 1994, 20 years ago, time travels. At the moment, one of the things that we're trying to work on in the retail, in brands, is to make that time travel a little bit slower and let people stay with us a little bit longer. So my current focus, after many years of working on the digital environments on the high streets and partially also with the digital environments behind the scenes, I got to the point where everything just got together and it's omni-channel. But we did start in 1994, and that was the first time when consumers really started participating and we started connecting them, or at least that's what we thought. But what we really connected with the first cyber cafes was just a bunch of geeks. So people like John and a few other of us were connected to each other, and we thought it was excellent. But since then, obviously, a lot more people connected, and I moved on after Siberia to Topshop, mainly because we didn't really get any traction with connecting women. The first few years were really hard work, because internet was still perceived very much as an anorak area. I don't know if you're probably too young to remember anoraks, but it was something not to go towards. Well, now it's probably a badge of honor. But at that time, it was really damn hard work to get women online. That was my main interest. So I sort of slowly shifted to areas where women were interested in and started adding technology as a kind of little add-on on the side. So I landed in Topshop, wrote the first e-commerce engine for Topshop and Dorothy Perkins of old places. And this is where I started noticing customers' subversiveness and the need to talk back. Because it's not quite today, it started all the way back in 1998 where they just got the voice. But that voice was heard by us and by the bosses. Today the voices are heard more laterally, and I think it's a much bigger challenge. So we work with all the beautiful women to relaunch Topshop in the first place, because those of you who remember Topshop originally was a very, very low brand. And after many years of working, it became a really, truly directional brand. So after a few years of working in retail, we started getting to the point where retail, online, mobiles, everything started merging. So just give you a little bit of figures. This is the only slide with figures, so don't worry. But I just thought that it's important to know where we are and what does it mean in terms of the sharpness of the movement. The first figure, which is really important for me, is the rise in 14.2% in UK online fashion, clothing, and footwear. And that's really accelerating. I remember when we started doing that, and people were just having a laugh, like, what do you mean people will buy clothes online? People do. And it's not so much just women, but men buy clothes online. How many of you shop for clothes online? Right, okay, so you know that figure is going to double very, very soon. And that has got massive implications for what we do and how the consumers participate in that process. So at the moment, we're looking at about 10.7 billion of spend online with 2013-14. Again, I would expect that to be about 12 to 13 next year and maybe around 20 in 3 years' time. So these are big numbers. And if you look at the last numbers, probably the most important, 70% of all fashion and clothing and footwear spent, it's online. So 70% comparing to 3% on food. Food is still tiny. So if you look at Tesco, Ocado, all of them are paddling very fast and building dark stores to catch up. But the primary food purchase is still in store. And that's a great opportunity because it will shift, but it will shift within the next probably 10 years, not within the next 3 years. So the next 3 years, we're really talking about fashion, sportswear, clothing, footwear in my area. So if you go back to the slide, which you know we'll all love and remember, I just wanted to revisit it because when you look at what's happening with the customers, they do have the Wi-Fi now. We have badgered the cities enough to get Wi-Fi introduced, so it's sort of happening. But the implication of it, what people do with this Wi-Fi, have really changed. So initially, it was just to get online to do your work. But when you look at what people now, we are definitely looking at the self-actualization. And this is the age of participation. What is this, what people want to do online when they actually get there, and when they sit in the cafe, in the coffee shop, what it is, what they do with themselves? These are the kinds of questions which I wanted to explore a little bit today. One number which sort of really spoke to me last week, we spent, when we open our email, over 50% of us opens the email on the mobile. So that's a combination of mobile and tablet, phone and tablets, and that's growing extremely fast. And many, many retailers are not even responsive at the moment. The design is not web responsive. There's still a lot to catch up. But just the thinking, where is your customer at the point of first contact, still hasn't shifted. And we have to remember that PC is really just a cash deal. We go back to PC just to finalize the order. So everything has become multi-device, including the shopping basket is multi-device. And even more importantly, we spend more time on devices than we sleep. Which I thought, okay, this is again first time in August the numbers started, the dial started shifting to working on devices versus sleeping. And I do understand, you know, sleep probably is overrated. You know, I always thought that Thatcher was onto something having only 4 hours of it. But again, what does it mean for our relationship with the customer if so much of that time is spent in the virtual environment? And these are very, very big questions. So we sort of took a step back and looked at who is doing what and what are demographics at the moment. And you know, whatever names you give them, everybody calls it differently. But if you look at from the beginning, the millennial Millie, so my daughter, 14-year-old, definitely more time on devices than sleeping, very little sleeping, in fact. Then younger mom, kind of around 30, 32, most of ordering for babies is happening online at the moment. So that's a massive shift in the consumer demographics because women so far quite liked going to John Lewis and touching things, and particularly the baby stuff was always very touchy-feely. They're too busy. They're not doing that. So that's shifted. slightly older, sort of 45 plus connected calves, shopping online. I go to a choir. My choir is probably about that age. Everybody does shopping on the mobile in the break in a choir because they just don't want to be bothered with it at any other point of time. So again, the time on the device suddenly expanded in the areas where before probably would be considered a bit more private. And then when wired will, you know, everybody's online all the time, you guys all devices. And retired Bill, that's my dad, who sort of was a little bit reluctant, but now barely visits the high street. Everything is done online, and everything needs to be done online because his mobility is decreasing. So we suddenly have massive expansion of the older generation that maybe they would like to get out a bit more, but quite often they're limited. And that's an area which is really not touched by enough brands. You know, the assumption is, oh, well, you know, over 65, they're not really there. They're there. They're much more on the tablets than anybody else. They register much more online than they do on the high streets. They have never been big players on the high streets, but now they're very big players online. So the brands notice that, and the shift is occurring extremely fast. And sort of one of the key pivotal moments where the customer, with all this time invested online, is now expecting us to say thank you for that. So one thing with that, with fashion, we gave the power to the customers, and now the fans don't just follow the front row. So last week, I don't know how many of you watched the Topshop fashion shows. It was one of the highest live stream watched events ever. But what was interesting, a lot of collection was released before. The collections were released to the press in the probably about 60%, but a lot of the collection was released to the fans, straight to the Instagrammers, the key bloggers, who were invited behind the scenes, shown the collection, and that went out. For people who follow fashion, this is an absolutely seismic change because the way fashion is constructed is obviously leadership first, which is, you know, Hilary Alexander in Daily Telegraph and Vogue and Marie Claire and whoever. But now the brands are realizing that actually, for the mainstream brands, that's not where it's at anymore, that the consumer is really not that bothered about what the elite press says. They want to know what the peer group is saying, and they want to know now. So the peer group suddenly shot up in terms of the strength of the opinion and generating that social negotiation of the value happens laterally, not horizontally. And that's happening at the moment because it's quite enough of people online that they can do these rituals for themselves. Because frankly, if you look at the top end brands, the reason why you end up paying £5,000 for a bag because Vogue wrote it's the right bag. But if you step behind and you can talk to all your peer group, you're like, really? That bag? 5,000? No way. While before people wouldn't have the platform for those conversations. They would have to go and believe whatever Vogue said. So that is a very different situation. It's pretty scary, actually. So bloggers got to see designs before the press last week, and it was amazing. It was amazing how quickly it went out, how excited they were about it, how quickly they picked up, and how quickly their selling started as well, because Topshop was also selling. So the sneak peek pre-show for the Insta girls, it was all kind of a little bit experimental. The press was quite upset. We got, you know, there's a whole lot of comments about it. But, you know, that's the way it's going. And the consumer has recovered the power, and I don't think they're going to give it back. So what the fashion brands are doing, they're basically introducing the area of access all areas for the brand ambassadors. Those people who invest all this time online, who spend all this time on social media, who never go to sleep, they now given recognition. You know, you are our partners. You are the real brand ambassador. You are worth our time before we give it to the press. So some of the pieces from Topshop went on the show, on the e-commerce site after the collection, and they went off immediately. Twitter shares were in thousands. And it was actually quite interesting because, again, that age of participation, I don't know if you've seen the piece in Telegraph comparing tweets, number of followers on Twitter for Burberry's, which is 3 million, and Marks & Spencer, which was 54.54, and much drama, oh my God, isn't Marks & Spencer behind? I felt like, you're not comparing apples with apples. You're comparing a global brand that's aspirational, where everybody will have a look, very, very few people will buy, versus a brand like Marks & Spencer, which is, you know, everyday stuff, which we need. And therefore, 540,000 followers is just fine. Trust me, they're fine. But the fact that Daily Telegraph picked it up with the front page in business, it just makes me think that we really need to talk a lot more about education, what matters, what doesn't, because the poor marketing departments were slaughtered on the day. Like, what do you mean you don't have as many followers as Burberry? And people get a little, because it's stupid. It's like, I shouldn't be doing that. So it's, in a way, it's your job to go and educate, because people get bullied into doing the wrong things because Telegraph doesn't understand. I think a little bit of that is also, you know, being contrarian, but the truth is that you've got the knowledge and you need to look after the brands and you need to look after the retailers, because they're busy trading. You know, they're not reading the social media metrics the whole day long. So you need to. So just carrying on the exploring the best practice on participation. This is one of my very, very favorite retailers, Mista. It was born from a kitchen in Shoreditch. A very good designer, which essentially created peer-to-peer shoe, very high-end design shoe net. The whole sector has exploded. I mean, over 50% rise on footwear worldwide. And we're expecting that to be, it's just giant. I don't know, but footwear and online goes really well. So what they are doing, they started probably around 6 months ago, getting the fans together. So treating the platform, the brand, as a platform for the fans to get together and do stuff. So one of the interpretations of that was tweet for cheaper. I think Burberry started it, but they couldn't really get anywhere with it because, you know, however many of us tweet for cheaper, it still costs bloody £8,000 for a jacket. You know, it's like, come on. So Mista is a lot lower price point. It's about £150. And it was enough for about 100 people to tweet a particular design together to get the price dropped to by around 30%. That's fine. That's a deal. So in that point, Mista has done really nice solutions. So gave opportunity for the fans to get together and achieve something that individually wouldn't be possible. It was really great. And they followed up with it with similar solutions for playlists and generating stuff that people could do it if they got together. So that getting together bit is our bit, is where we can help. Quite often it's very simple. This is like something like I really love. L'Oreal has launched a little app which allows you to try the new colors and new collections without actually having to put it on. So it basically recognizes as computer vision recognition of your facial features, and you choose from few looks and it overlays on your face. I'm actually not wearing any makeup at this point. It's all overlaid on my face by the app, which I thought was great, and I tweeted it to everywhere. So did everybody else, because it's basically a time saver. So for somebody who's not particularly obsessed with makeup, having to put it on to try is really a waste of time. So if you can do it instantaneously, but try it, of course it will go out. So again, the fans of the brand get a little bit of pretext to promote the brand. So out of, you know, not really caring that much, I'm now L'Oreal ambassador. Who would have thought? It's massive with my daughter's generation because it's the same, they just love it. So giving the fans something to support their natural need to share and promote is often quite enough. It just got to be something very good. Another one is Idesso. This is now, they're now working with River Island, Zara, Next, and quite a few other high street retailers. Similar concept, it allows you to try code virtually by just click of the button. So you don't have to go with five codes to the sweaty and hot changing room and try everything on. This is just drops it on your body. Yes, no, thank you. I probably went through about 15, which in real life, no way. I might have tried one, two, maybe three, but that would be it. So this is a way of getting people to try, but also to share, because you can click the button and share. Creating information, massive analytics for the brand, because obviously the demand, you never know what who likes what. You would have never known how many people liked your coat, because not that many people would have ever managed to get into the changing room. So this is a new knowledge. The easier the process of fitting, the more knowledge is generated by the fans. The less time the fitting takes, the more styles you're likely to try. Again, analytics for the brands, amazing. So sharing and buying instantaneous, generating knowledge, giving pretext to share, and keeping everybody happy. But where I wouldn't go too far with it, which is why we wanted to pick up on the age of participation, I think the temptation always is that the data generated with sharing, data generated with the dashboards, data analytics of any sort, it's extremely tempting. And you know, people who come from numeric backgrounds is like, ooh, something, at last something to count on, as opposed to having to second guess the customer. Because in fashion, clothing, maybe a bit less sportswear, most of the work we do is just second guessing. Because by the time you get your data in, the customer has moved on. By the time you know they bought a red lipstick, they're probably not going to buy another red lipstick. So you constantly have to guess. But one thing we've noticed, people sort of started obsessing with the big data. And in fact, you know, those of you who have stats background, it's phishing. I mean, it really is phishing. Because you're never going to uncover as much details as you like to, because it's a moving target. You know, it's not geology, it's not your genome, it's living people who change their mind every day or more often. So yes, it's great to have it, but you know, don't obsess about it, because that's not what it's all about. And where we are at the point of data, if you talk about age of participation, people really don't necessarily want to give that much data to anybody. You know, if I'm buying a coat from Zara, I wouldn't mind them knowing my size, but apart from that, it's not their fucking business. So I think we have to establish that people are not that interested in sharing details that are not considered necessary. Big data people love everything. You know, cross the road, had a coffee, what kind of coffee, what was in the coffee, who did she call for? Fuck it, you know, it doesn't matter. It does not matter. Look at Tesco. They had all the big data known to men. They've just bought themselves Socionomics. They have bought every single tiny big data company going. What happened yesterday? 250 million overstating of profit? Really? This is not one, you know, Kellogg's. This is gazillions of products that they missed. So between me and you know, big data is fine. Where it was, tiny department in the back, business analytics guys, only bring them up when you need them. Otherwise, don't bother. So where we look at this big data use, okay, occasionally it's useful, but something to remember at this point, if you want to have participation with your customers, you have to give them trust, and they have to trust you. Otherwise, it's not really participation. So we started looking at, you know, what are the boundaries? Where are we safe asking for more questions, and where is better to leave alone? So there's a work from an American lady called Katie Humillion, who sort of started making it a little bit more granular. So in some cases, total anonymity, it's fine, because you still know, for example, location-based information. If you know that somebody has triggered a beacon on the high street, you know they're on the high street. They will probably want coffee. All of us want coffee all the time. It's safe to assume if you're on the high street, it doesn't matter if you're male or female, you will want coffee. So the anonymity can be preserved by having additional information of a different sort. I don't really want to know your gender. I just want to know you're a human being. You will want coffee. But there is other end of the spectrum where maybe some brands will enter into relationship with you where they're prepared to give you a little bit more. And that sort of pseudo-anonymity, a little bit more, a little bit, until it's fully verified. So your relationship with your GP is probably fully verified. They know everything about you. They know the state of your bowels. That's a verified relationship. But the more the reason to look after it and not sell it, as the government's trying to do. So you just have to pitch it to every brand to think what they really need. Because if they ask for too much without a reason, people get extremely peed off. If you don't ask enough, then you don't know what to offer them. And there is an algorithm to tell you that. You've got to work it out kind of bit by bit. So you know, the future high street, any minute now, will look like that, where basically iBeacons, NFCP, RFID, whatever, things will be happening on the high street because that's more important information, location and context than anything else. So the high street challenge is to really capture the right information, but in a trusted way that people won't bother that we want too much because we shouldn't ask too much. And then moving on from there, one thing which we can do in terms of enhancing the relationship with the customer is the whole shift in values. So when we were looking at the Maslow triangle, what it is, what people do with the Wi-Fi, quite a lot they're campaigning. We sort of moved from passive, slightly apathetic, cynical, and bored lot to, wow, you know, everybody is on a march. Everybody is doing something. Yesterday there was a march in London. I think 500,000 people showed up for the climate change. So, you know, a few years ago, it would be pretty unthinkable because UK is not a place for revolution. UK is a place for kind of quiet evolution. But somehow it shifted to people being really active. So Kimberly Clark is one of the nice examples of it, where they always were in trouble for cutting the green forest and doing horrible things. And now they're one of the highest ranking sustainable companies. So they got themselves out of the hole by doing the right things, but they're also telling people about it. So Andrex at the moment is looking for that conversation with the customer. I know they found one. They're running a campaign about the toilets in India because, as we discovered, there is more mobile phones in India than there is toilets. So Andrex is thinking kind of long term. If they help with the campaign, eventually their brand will go there and they align the value of the brand with the need for campaign that people are showing at the moment, because the age of participation is all about campaigning. And where, what to campaign for? I mean, your brand has got to find something that people care about, but also something that needs to be fixed and something that's out there already. And when you look at what's out there already, there's a lot of problems. You know, we're living in London, which is more and more overcrowded, and I think it's going to get worse. We live in a place where bikers can't safely bike. 25% of East London commutes by bike, but how many of these people have accidents? How many deaths last year? These are the areas which are really painfully in need of campaigning. If yours or your customer brand is anywhere overlaid with any of that, those are the areas that are in dire need for fixing. And I've got a couple of brands who are looking at it at the moment, but I'm just amazed that more brands are not aligning themselves with what the customers care about, because the age of participation is really the age of campaigning. And you're not going to campaign for products that most of us have to sell, but you're going to campaign for better biking in London. So if there is a way of aligning that, some brands are obviously better than others. Health for Heroes, which is one of my charities, it's very aligned with technical companies. Because if people work for IBM or for Hewlett-Packard or for Oracle, and those are brands which there isn't really anything kind of spiritual to hang on to. If they support in a large scale a charity that's quite technical, which Health for Heroes are one of the most technical charities in terms of their progress on human enhancement, you give something back to your staff, but you also give something to your customers to talk about. So this is what brings us back to what Michael was saying, what the customers want to talk about. If you don't grab them and force the conversation direction, they will talk about how crap is your brand. And unfortunately, social media have got prevalence for negative. I'm not quite sure what the psychology of it, but if you give people have a chance, they will moan. They will not praise your brand, but they will complain. They will not be brand ambassadors, but they will be brand moaners. Some brands are more prone to it than others, but on the whole, I can guarantee you, out of the messaging on your customer service, majority of it will be negative. So we've got to find some way of wrestling that back, and the values, the campaigning, finding a conversation which suits the person but also suits the brand is probably where it's at. Another big area for me is the social networking for the seniors. Those are American numbers, but ours are going up very, very fast. And that aligns well with a lot of brands. A lot of brands are with a slightly senior customer. We're coming to the rabbit, wait. One area also which is desperately needing for alignment with bigger brands is this whole idea of sharing resource and doing something together. People wrote lots of apps. There is lots of apps for everything. But now to maintain an app and to actually sustain it, it's quite hard work. It's very difficult for a startup to do it. So when we're looking at apps like sharing a car, Freecycle Network, Pet Owners Exchanging, you know, they have almost no sponsorship. And I'm almost amazed. Where are the brands who are pointless, useless products that nobody really needs? And here you've got beautiful solutions that everybody needs. They've got to get together. And it's kind of our job to make that happen and align it with the need to support what people need with the capacity of the brand that needs a little bit of campaigning, but heaven will figure out what it does. Bunnies. Right, so if you look at the bunny app, this is another area which I really like that. Bunnies don't easily align with everybody until you realize that all children like bunnies. So a couple of toys companies are looking to sponsor that app. This is the app for looking after your bunny when you're away. Apparently, there is no such thing like a bunny hotel. Bunnies die in hotels, which probably is quite telling. So bunny needs to go somewhere loved to another home. So somebody wrote an app about sharing a bunny. They just needed a little bit of money, and they found the brand which was aligned with the children's interest and, you know, happy bunnies. And there is tons of it. Another one is the Regent's Park Poop app. I don't know if you're near Regent's Park, but there's a lot of chihuahuas around, and there's a lot of French owners who don't pick up the poop. Not that I'm, you know, anything against the French, but they don't. So we supported the brand, the app, which basically you can send a notification where accidents happen, and then you can track, well, without being sinister, to track the owner of that and sort of show where's the French side of the Regent's Park and what happens there. You know, again, there's so many brands that should be right there supporting it because it's such a great story. You know, the French was like, oh, I don't know our chihuahuas, but they were. And the car sharing is massive. You know, car sharing in London is just as big as Shift in bike sharing. Again, nobody supports it. It's easy to do. It's easy to implement. Plenty of brands that want to do that. So just to finish it off, I think age of participation for me, it's not just sort of praying for the best and hanging out there hoping that the customer will like you. They might, but then again, they are much more prone to complain than to say that you are great. So in order to wrestle that conversation, you've got to give them a platform to do what they like doing, which is campaigning. So strength in numbers, we are all campaigners now, we are all quite engaged. You might argue that our engagement is a little bit of the clicktivism, so you know you click for engagement, but you know, I take that, it's better than nothing. So what brand can win is the one that will pick it up and run with it and own that engagement. We're not going to talk about beacons, but one of the things which I started from is the information and the anonymity. What matters, I think what matters most is where people are and what time they are there. And that sort of takes care of not asking them too many questions because that in itself is sufficient. We tested that in Barbican conference recently. And it was quite amazing how many things you can sell to people just by knowing where you are. But you also have to give them something to support that. So what we tested there was an app for a conference which also gave them ability to have Twitter feeds per room and conversations per topic and quite granular self-organized groupings, which was great. And I think that's the way, that's the direction for me that we need to be looking at. So just to wrap it up, you know, times are tough, digital wins. Nobody knows what's going to come up tomorrow. Probably something make our work a lot harder. But don't pray for an easy life. Pray for the strength to endure a difficult one. Okay, thank you.